Thank you for coming. My name is Shrikanth Shankar, and I work for a company called Qubole. I'm going to talk a little bit about how you can build data-driven applications using Qubole. So I'll just start off with like a brief introduction to Qubole and what we do. Qubole is a big data platform as a service company. We've taken the big data stack, which is Hadoop, Hive, Uzi, Scoop, packaged it up, put it behind a rich set of APIs and UI, and we offer that as a service. We run on top of the Amazon cloud currently, but we're moving to some of the other cloud stacks fairly soon. So our realization was that the, you know, Hadoop's been great on-premise. It, you know, there's a lot of people doing very cool things with it. When you move the stack, when you take the stack and move it to cloud, you're suddenly presented with an opportunity. And the opportunity is that when you run things on-premise, there's assumptions about hardware and so on. You know, you can't just go out and get like a 100-node cluster in a minute. It just doesn't work that way. If you're running on Amazon, you can make an API call and you can get a 100-node cluster. So what we fundamentally believed was that we should, that the stack was great. It was the right stack for doing big data, for data-driven work and big data work. But that when you ported it to the stack, you had to think a lot about how you would actually run this. And you wanted to make it easy, fast, and reliable for end users. And that's what we built, right? So our thesis was, when you run things on a cloud, when you run things as a service, you want to make it easy for end users to come in and run a Hadoop job or a Hive query. And those people are thinking, the level of abstractions that they care about is, I want to run a Hadoop job. I want to run a Hive query. And most of the tools out there today are work at the level of clusters. They'll tell you, set up a Hadoop cluster on Amazon, you know, add a few nodes, remove a few nodes, which is great if you're an ops folk, which are, if you come from an ops background, but if you're actually focused on doing data work, you want to write a Hive query or write a MapReduce job or do something like that, that's not the level of, right level of abstraction. So that's what we did. We took the stack, did a whole bunch of work to make it run fast on Amazon, wrote a whole bunch of control logic to make sure that we could orchestrate clusters on the cloud efficiently, and we've been live for, I guess, eight months now and have a whole bunch of customers. So what I'm going to talk about a little bit here is how you actually build an app, and there's sort of two different sites here. api.qubole.com is what we offer as a service. That's where, as a customer, you would come in and get access to a functionality. And we have demotrends.qubole.com, which is sort of a sample app, and I'll show you what Demotrend has, which is basically a visualization of some data that you can process, right? And I'll walk you through the process of sort of getting to demotrends.qubole, which is this something interesting that you can discover about data, and how you would build it using api.qubole. So this is what demotrends.qubole.com looks like. I took this snapshot last night, and I might have been able to show you something live, except I'm not on my laptop. What this does is it looks at Wikipedia and says, what are the trending topics as of today and as of this month? And trending is sort of defined as, you know, what's the normal rate of viewership on this, and what's the spike? Has it suddenly spiked? So it's not like the absolute number of views, but it's a day over day, right? So if something was viewed like 100,000 times and then viewed 110,000 times, that's not trending versus something that was viewed like 100 times yesterday and now is being viewed 50,000 times, right? The second one is, there's something's happened, something's generated interest. And as of yesterday, these were the trending topics, right? NASA, I guess, because of the government shutdown, people kind of took things down. There was a climate report out and a bunch of other things. Now, I'll be honest, this is not very enlightening. And this is not very enlightening because we aren't very good data scientists, right? We're engineers who build platforms for data scientists. So what we've done is sort of a proof of concept, right? I'm sure there's people in this audience who'll do a much better job given the same data set and the tools that we built. We built tools. We built this to show you what you could build with our tools. So take it with a pinch of salt. It's not exactly the best example. And all this code, by the way, is up on GitHub. You can get access to all of it, and you can use it, sort of repeat the experiments as you will. here's the input, right? So what Wikipedia does is Wikipedia publishes page counts for every single file. So every hour, they say, this page was hit so many times in the last hour. And they push it out to a web page, right? So effectively, there's a top-level page for a month, and underneath that, there's a page for every hour, you know, which has page, you know, a page title, and how many times it was viewed in that last hour. And that's sort of one of the basics of, that's one of the core input for what we've turned around and done. The other side of the input, and I'll talk about it a little bit later, is there's some interesting MySQL tables that Wikipedia also publishes as a MySQL dump. And we've sort of taken that, imported it into a running MySQL instance. And that's needed for some normalization. I'll talk to you a little bit about what that happens, right? So here were the sources, right? So we had a page count, which is this 2 billion per 2 billion rows a month, which has just two columns: what the title of the page on Wikipedia was, and what was the views. And this is at an hour's granularity. And the two MySQL tables are the two things: the redirect and page table that you see underneath the covers. And that's needed because Wikipedia has the concept of a redirect title and a true title. So if you go to the country India, right? I think India is kind of the canonical title, but if you go to Bharat, which is what you know, which is another synonym, that redirects to India. Or you go to Barack H. Obama, I think that redirects to Barack Obama. So there's a lot of these redirects, and the counts that they publish, are basically for the title, not the canonical title. So if you get like 100 views for India and 100 views for Bharat, if you're really interested in how many people viewed a particular page in Wikipedia, you kind of have to sum those up. So there's a little bit of normalization, you know, fairly standard ETL cleansing stuff that anybody would end up doing. And so let me just kind of walk you through the process of what we do. You have these 2 billion counts a month that you want to get from a web page. You have these redirect and page counts, which again you're kind of getting in from a MySQL dump. You create a lookup table, which basically says, given the title, what's the actual, you know, what's the canonical title that you're going to use, and you'll join these two page counts to basically get what's the daily views of the true title, right? So you'll join these two tables, and you'll do a group by on basically the date. And you'll end up with a count for how many people viewed a particular page on that. So that's the next table. And then once you have, so you'll get the true page count. From that, you go to the daily page count. And then you can do a trend analysis. And the trend analysis that we did was, let's look at how many, you know, over a month, what was the slope, and whether over the last day, the slope has been radically different from everything else that you do. Just in terms of the technologies, we did all of our transformations, a lot of the analyze phase, et cetera, using Hive. This is sort of what it talks about, right? So we had a script that would run periodically, would go pull data out of the wherever Wikipedia published it, dump it into a Hive table. We had another script that runs periodically, grabs the MySQL dump that Wikipedia publishes, dumps it into another Hive table. And then we have a series of Hive queries that do a bunch of analysis. They first join these two tables to get kind of the canonical count, canonicalize the name of the page. Then they aggregate it to get daily counts. And then they do some, they use a Python script to do some arithmetic on how you actually calculate the trend stuff. And so you can sort of divide this into two different pieces. There's the import and export, which is basically, you know, how do you get data from multiple different sources into a single system so that you can process them in one place? That's the, you know, the ETL to get the page count, the ETL to get the pages and the redirect thing. And finally, when you've done all this work, you want to push the result. So this app that I showed you was a simple Ruby on Rails app that we wrote, and it fetches data from a MySQL table. And the MySQL table is just storing, you know, for each topic on each day, what is the trend score. And so this this Ruby on Rails app is just going to the MySQL table and saying, get me the top 10, you know, order by something, descending, get me the top 10, and then show me how the views have looked like over the last 10 days or whatever. So eventually, so the point is that you first fetch data from a bunch of sources, you do a bunch of analysis. Once you've done that, you export to a MySQL table so that you can turn around and visualize it in some tool that you built or some, you know, something like Tableau or that you like. So let's talk a little bit about the integration piece. For the first piece that we had to do was fetch some website, you know, web log data that was sitting in a web page that Wikipedia hosts. We also had to fetch data from MySQL instances, and for that we use an Apache project called Scoop. So Qubole actually offers Scoop as a service, so you can come in, export data from relational systems and non-relational. We support Mongo, Cassandra, Google Analytics, a bunch of these, and stick them into S3. And then once they're in S3 and in Hive tables, you can then join them with other Hive tables to get results. And then at the tail end of the process, when you have the results in a Hive table, you can use Scoop again to export them to MySQL so that your transactional app has access to them. And that's what we did, right? So we wrote a simple Python script. This Python script just goes run, you know, given a day, it'll go fetch the data for all of that day, and it'll upload to S3 into a very well-known place, and it puts it into a Hive table. And for those of you who know Hive, it just creates like a daily partition. There's a daily bucket for each, there's a directory for each day, and that becomes a partition in Hive. And so we get all this data from Wikipedia, upload it to S3, and create a Hive partition. And we use DB import, like I said, which runs on top of Scoop to bring in the MySQL tables, and DB export to push it to the MySQL stuff. And once we have that, the first step was to kind of cleanse the data, right? So you got these daily views, and like I said, they were they're based on the original title, not sort of the canonical title. So you take this, join it with the MySQL dump, and canonicalize it. So you say, okay, you know, Barack Obama views were like 10,000. There was another 100,000 views for Barack H. Obama. So I'm going to count those together and get 110,000 views for the canonical page. And that gives you basically for each canonical page how many people have viewed that over the last day. And then you want to look at counts over days, because what we're doing is, like I said, our trend analysis was we don't really care about the absolute views in today. We care about what the views were yesterday and how much the change has been, so sort of the slope of the curve. And to calculate that, we need to kind of look at the views over multiple days, right? So we need to take basically a group by, take count all, you know, the last 30 days worth of views, and basically build one row in SQL. So those of you who know SQL, it's usually a pivot operation that, you know, Hive doesn't support, so we ended up writing a custom UDF. And then we do the actual calculation of the trend, like which one is trending the most, in a Python script, because it was easy to write, and we had to do row over row calculations, and that you can take the Python script and embed it in a Hive query. So, and that's pretty much what we did in the analyze portion. The Hive query normalizes counts, collects the counts across days, and then you have the Python script to do the trend calculation. Let me show you a screenshot of a bunch of the things. So this was, I guess, our screenshot from yesterday. I know this is kind of really hard to view. I'm sorry. I was hoping to show this on my laptop and that I've been able to control this font size a little better. But if you kind of squint and look at it cleanly, the Qubole supports something called a shell command, right? It's an arbitrary shell command. You can come and run it against our system. We'll kind of provision a machine, make sure it runs and does all the nice things. And this shell command runs a Python script that we wrote, which connects to the Wikipedia site and fetches this, and then eventually creates the Hive partition. So this was step one. This is then we end up creating another table here. And then this is a Hive query that we've run, which basically takes a bunch of data, normalizes them, and creates a normalized page count. So again, you probably have to squint a little bit, but it's basically doing an insert overwrite into one table and is doing it using an inner join, right? So it's taking the title, joining it with this other lookup table to get the canonical table, and then getting the counts. This was a Hive temporary UDF that we wrote. So for those, so what we wanted to do was, like in a single row for a page, we wanted to represent 30 days worth of dates and 30 days worth of counts. And that's not something SQL will, you know, like I said, it's a pivot. You have to represent it as an array, which is a complex type. So we wrote a Hive UDF, which does this, which takes all this data, groups it into, groups the 30 days worth of data, puts it into an array, and then returns the array. And then this is the real query, right? So again, a little bit of squinting. There's, if you see the SQL statement, in the middle of it, there's a Python script that basically runs and does the actual calculation. And you can actually find this Python script on GitHub. It's on our Qubole thing under something called demo trends. And this Python script just reads a bunch of rows. So it'll read a single row from standard input that'll have all the information about a single page, 30 days worth of data. It does a bunch of math to figure out what the trend score for this particular row should be based on the 30-day count. And it emits that. It says, okay, for this page, this is the trend score. And then eventually there's an order by that says, okay, sort them by trend score so that the one that's trending the most shows up at the top. Let me go back to my presentation here. So these were a series of steps that we ended up writing, right? So we wrote something to import the data, we wrote something to do some analysis, some transform, and then eventually we exported out. Now, if you really want to display this for people day over day, what you want to do is you want to take this complex workflow that you have and then run it on a daily cadence, right? You want to say every day at this time, go first download all the new data that's come since the last time I ran this, and then rerun all these Hive queries that we're talking about that allow you to normalize the data and process it, and then finally do the export on a daily cadence. And that's again something that Qubole supports. We support the concept of jobs, which are nothing but, you know, you can think of them as simplified cron, but they allow more complex things like data dependencies and data pipelines. So you can say run this job only if the one before it finished. And the net result is we took this entire package of things and we run it every day. So every day it goes, fetches a bunch of new counts from Wikipedia, you know, fetches any new pages that have been created in the last 24 hours and so on, redoes the normalization just for the last 24 hours worth of data, and then reruns the trend calculation, you know, starting today, go back 30 days. So it reruns all those Hive queries. And at the end of it, when you have, like, okay, what were the trending topics for today and what were the last trending topics for the last 30 days, it pushes that into a MySQL database, which you can just go off and push, you know, which you can view in our Demo Trends app. And so if you go back there, if you go to the demotrends.qubole.com, you can then see what were the trending topics on any specific day since we've started running this app. And this screenshot is basically of us, of our job pipeline page. And so we've created like three workflows, you know, one for import, one for the analyze, and one for the export. And these things will, they'll run at a frequency of a day. And our page will tell you, you know, what's happened to the last few instances. Have they run successfully? Have they completed? You get access to all the logs. It allows you to do things like, you know what, yesterday's job failed, so let me kind of rerun just that one day's worth of job, et cetera. So it's a complete job management framework. With that, I guess I'm kind of done.